Sake het onlangs 'n beraad gehou waar kommer uitgespreek is oor verskeie maatreëls wat eiendomsreg soos in die grondwet omskryf en gewaarborg vir water. Verder bestaan verwarring oor watter model nou eintlik toegepas behoort te word om grondhervorming te versnel terwyl voedselsekerheid gehandhaaf word. So, kom ons praat oor plaasbesit en grondgebruik. Ons gaste is Mandisa Makasini van die EFF en Cornelius Jansen van Rensburg AfriSake. Maar eerst hoor ons wat sê professor Petika Ntuli, een kunstenaar en geskiedkundige.
In the context of South Africa, the land question is quite a very critical one. And the land is critical not only for its economic value, but also for spiritual value. When you raise the issue of land, you are raising other people's tempers. You are raising people's kind of anger. I think the 1913 Act that appropriated 87% of the land for the settler community and 30% for the black people had been a very contentious one. But that's a historical event. We have got the constitution that is a very celebrated by the world over, that we have got to do what we have to do according to the constitution. And then the appropriation of land without compensation lies in the world of anarchy, not in a democracy. It will be very difficult to find somebody who sits in parliament, who respects parliament, who is proud to be a member of parliament, but at the same time, people would want to come up with the issue of anarchy. That becomes a very serious contradiction in terms. We are in a position in South Africa that increasingly younger people are working together, they go to school together, they fall in love together, they are creating a new kind of South Africa, and yet we still have got a few people who are still stuck actually into the past. The issue of Zimbabwe and the land grab is also being looked at outside its understanding. What were the agreements that were made between the British government and the Zimbabwe government? What was a 10-year lease, willing seller, willing buyer deal? That's what South Africa is actually offering. Willing seller, willing buyer. The land belongs to those that are occupying it at the moment. It's government that can then make interventions. But at the same time, there are very progressive ways, like some farmers in the Cape, wine farmers, who have given part of their land to the people who have worked there all their lives and helped them to start their own businesses while they are still working for the farmer. The people are independent, they are making for their shares, they are running their own business. You can't even raid that farm because you are going to be blocked by the people who have been given that. So in other words, the way forward is that government should clarify its land claim processes, work up the issue of willing seller, willing buyer principle. If it means that government has got to buy some kind of a land in order to give back that land to the people who actually deserve it, those can actually be done within a democratic dispensation.
'N paar perspektiewe van professor Ntuli, baie dankie daarvoor. Ek wil net ook een dingetjie regstel, Mandisa sê vir my, van is eintlik Mashego en nie Makasini soos wat ons gesê het nie. Sy staan eintlik in vir Andile wat hier so moes gewees het, so ons is baie dankbaar dat sy kort kennisgewing hier so is. So I want to start with you. If you think about land, do you have an emotional attachment to land? How serious is it for you as a human being?
Firstly, I'm a single parent. And it's a struggle surviving Johannesburg, being an African female who has basically inherited poverty as part of your genetic makeup. And so it's very simple. The land issue is not only emotional and it's not only sentimental. It's just a practical issue for us Africans. We don't have access to land for our own, private use, to have a house to live in. So it affects
that
issues.
That was the case?
It affects issues of shelter. No, that is the case. Africans don't basically have access to land to freely compete even in the economy of South Africans in general, because land is very expensive. It's a private commodity, and it's sold in the commercial space. And so, you know, for an average South African who earns 50% of workers in South Africa, earn less than 3,500 rand a month. So that doesn't, I mean, what property can you buy with that? Okay. What land can you buy?
I understand that financial argument, but on an emotional level.
Let me finish. You may put up the argument and say that I might have access to land in the former Gangwane, for instance, which is the area where I predominantly grew up in,
or in the former
KwaZulu, or in the former KwaQwa. Well, that land, we all know, is not, firstly, even suitable for basic agriculture, for instance, because when the Land Act was passed, and before even the Land Act was passed, when the massive displacements of Africans happened in this country, Africans were basically shoved to the periphery of whatever land was available and shoved to dry, unusable land and small,
Let's get to this whole issue of stealing the land.
Yes.
Who stole land, when and where?
Yes, I think it's a well-documented fact that Europeans arrived in Africa, I think even from the 14, if not 1500s, other parts of Africa. In South Africa, we have a formal date, 1652, that basically notes the official arrival of Jan van Riebeck. Mm. And Jan van Riebeck, from my understanding, is not African, he's a European. Pretty much like yourself. And so we are not going to shy away from stating facts and truth simply because we are afraid of white people, because we are not. We live with whites as fellow citizens in South Africa, and in order to build a positive relationship with white citizens in South Africa, we must be honest. Whites stole the land in South Africa. It was stolen from us. In fact, stealing might even be mild, because our people were killed. Our people were murdered.
If you read the history, you know, there are so many things that went on in South Africa. The Sun people who arrived here probably 14,000 years ago. The Khoi people who were here 2,000 years ago, they fought with each other. They fought with the Khoza people. The Khoza people
fought
them.
I'm not sure. I can't engage in you.
The Mafikan, all the things that happened.
I can't engage on that level, because the Sun people that you talk about are Africans, firstly. Secondly, I might even be a descendant of the Khoi, because my mom is Xhosa. We are Africans. We are not non-Africans.
The Sun people actually lived all over.
Secondly, that was my first point. My second point, the Sun people didn't arrive here. They're Africans. They were here. And
there's
all other
argument,
Africans.
Course, there's
this concept of Africans having arrived somewhere within the borders of Africa is wrong. We mustn't digress.
No, there's
the
another
conversation. The reality is that whites stole the land violently from Africans. That is the reality. And the sooner we all accept the truth, the sooner we'll be able to move on and discuss real issues of how are we going to move this country to the place where 79.2% of this population, which happens to be African, and majority living under squalor and serious poverty, how we can get that part of the population to have decent lives and to partake in this economy in a fair and equitable manner.
I understand that. Cornelius, nou jy, die hele kwestie van steel, wat is jou perspektief daarop?
Nou, Freek, dit is 'n infame leen. Rasse kan nie grond steel nie. 'N ras, mense gebaseer op kleur, kan nie eiendom besit nie. Individue en gemeenskappe kan wel. Indien daar enige vorm van diefstal histories sou plaasgevind het, is daar 'n paar goed wat bewys moet word. Die eerste een is om te kan identifiseer wie was die spesifieke eienaar van 'n spesifieke bate gewees. Naam en van, en jy moet hom kan identifiseer. Tweedens moet jy kan bewys watter spesifieke bate was gesteel gewees. Dit kan nie gedoen word nie. Derdens moet jy op die individu kan wys wat daai grond gesteel het. Nou die EFF se verstaan van geskiedenis behoort bevraagteken te word.
Maar sy kan argumenteer, groepe het saam opgetree, soos die voortrekkers, hulle het in Silikaans byvoorbeeld verdryf uit die ou Transvaal uit in die huidige Zimbabwe in.
Kom ons vat dalk net die vroeë geskiedenis. Die swart stamme in Suid-Afrika het gemigreer van Suid-Sudan af. Hulle het oor die Limpopo gekom, wat 'n stuk water is, en Europeërs, Jan van Riebeck, hulle het oor die see gekom, wat net dalk 'n groter stuk water is. Beide het hier aangekom en 'n settlers. Die swart stamme het die Khoisan uitgemoor en verdryf na die dele van hierdie land toe wat woestynagtig is. Wat het toe gebeur? Op die stadium weet die gemeenskap of die stamme soos wat ons het vandag sien, nog nie vorm aangeneem nie. Een goeie voorbeeld is, in 2012 het die Zulus al 200-jarige bestaan gevier. Die Afrikaners is al 360 jaar in hierdie land. Wat het gebeur tydens die groot trek? Silkaats, en net na die Mefakane, het honderde duisende swart mense in hierdie land uitgemoor. Van hulle het gevlug so ver as Angola, so ver as Kenya. Toe die boere in die binnenland inkom, was het in niemands land gewees.
Maar die geschiedenis hier, en ek in die boekie so oop, staan die mythe van die leë land. Jy weet, so daar is eindelijk verskillende perspektiewe ook oor hierdie saak, en hoe die geschiedenis het loopgevat.
Daar is beslis. Ek meen, die feit dat ek sê, daar was in niemands land gewees, beteken nie, daar was nie ander mense gewees nie. Beteken daar was ander dele van die land gewees wat wel beset was nie. Kom ons vat het verder. Hoe het die voortrekkers grond bekom? Nommer 1 het hulle met ruiltransaksies probeer grond koop van die stamme. En ek dink die geval van Piet Retief is waarschijnlijk die beste voorbeeld daarvan. Dit is goed opgeteken. Die tweede is, deur dienste te gelever het en saam te gewerk het met sekere van die swart stamme ten tye van byvoorbeeld oorloë, is grond ook toe aan die boere gegee. Noord-Natal, Stelleland en Goosen is goeie voorbeelde. Die reg van verowering het ook een bepaalde impak gehad. Terwyl Silkaats bezig was om duisende Tswanas uit te moor in hierdie land, het die boere, die voortrekkers, hulle gaan help. Die grond, vooral in die Oud-Transvaal wat ingeneem was, was deur Silkaats beset gewees en is bekom die reg van verowering.
Let's just talk about that principle, because that is a fundamental difference, it seems to me, is the right to occupy because you conquer. And that has happened throughout history, you know, with Alexander the Great, Genghis Khan, and you can talk about whoever you want to. That right, because you've conquered, is that something that can be accepted by yourself or not?
We are not going to accept that. You know, the whole colonial history of Africa, you know, I don't, firstly, let me also just say that it's very disingenuous to invite us to a show and have a man speak a language I understand probably 10% of. But the little bit that I heard, I mean, the insult that is just thrown at people of Zulu origin, that they've just celebrated 200 years of their existence. I think even Shaka himself will come out of his grave and slap this man silly. So I'm not going to respond to that. And I'm not going to respond to some doctored European, you know, racist colonial talk about how Africa doesn't belong to Africans. I'm not going to engage in that. He can basically rant on that
on
his own.
Just hang on for one moment. It's clear that there's not going to be some kind of you know, agreement between the two of you about history, and it's difficult for us now to go into the entire history.
But I wasn't told that I'm coming here to agree on history.
No, of course not. But what I want to suggest to you, to both of you, is let's just take a quick break now, and then we talk about what now.
And then after the break, you must stop interrupting me and start interrupting your brother here.
But of course I do that as well.
You didn't interrupt him.
I gave fair chance
to you. He spoke freely.
Hang on. Dis nou tyd vir handelsnuus en ons is nou weer terug. Welkom terug. Ons gesels oor die besit van landbougrond en oor die vraag of die boere die grond gesteel het. Maar nou wil ons vorentoe gaan en kyk of ons hier kan uitkom nou, maar wat nou vorentoe? Die geskiedenis is 'n moeilike ding, maar wat nou vorentoe? So, let's start with you. The first thing that you must do is, of course, is get past the constitution. How are you going to do that?
Well, essentially, the EFF not so long ago offered the ANC in parliament its 6.2% share of the electoral spoils.
Vote, yeah.
And basically offered that to them. And obviously there was no response from the ANC desk to say that with their 62 or 63%, I'm not sure how much they have, they could then easily use the EFF 6.2% to attain two-thirds majority and basically take the land back, because our position as EFF, and as you know, we've got 6.2% in the National Assembly, we've got just over 10% in Gauteng, so we can't discuss, you know, government policy from an EFF point of view, because we are not essentially in government, so we're not in a privilege of implementing our policy. However, we are very clear.
Clause 25, that's what it's about in the Constitution.
Clause 25 of the Constitution, firstly, is also slightly misunderstood, because Clause 25 talks about private property rights being guaranteed to each individual. But at the same time, I've just given you, when you asked me, soon after you've introduced me, I explained to you very briefly something which I need not explain to anyone, the poverty levels that us Africans face in this country. So if private property is going to be guaranteed, private property rights are going to be protected and guaranteed under the Constitution, under Section 25, where does that leave 79% of the population who cannot access fairly, access private property because it's expensive? So what I'm saying is, it's very simple. The EFF's first pillar. We have seven cardinal pillars that we ascribe to. And the first one talks about land expropriation without compensation for equal redistribution. And so that is our stand, and we're not going to move away from it. And so when we offered the ANC 6.2%, our 6.2% in Parliament, was to make it easy for them to do that on the basis that we don't believe that it's even going to be feasible to buy back the land. At the rate at which the ANC is going now, 8% of land has been given back through their willing buyer, willing seller policy. If they continue at this rate 20 years down the line, or rather it's less than 20 years since they implemented the policy,
okay,
it's going to take them 100 years to give back to Africans 30% of the land. So it's a non-starter.
Okay, I want to talk to you also about the whole issue of the proposals on the table.
Yes.
But let's get his reaction also. So the yellow question from die grondwet, en dit is moontlik, soos wat sy sê, dat het verander kan word, né?
Freek, die grondwet is nie die waarborg wat ons gedink het in 94 was nie. Ons moet dit vir mekaar duidelik sê. Die bestaande wetgeving wat voor die parlement is, wat hier die ANC daar gestel word, sien baie duidelik daarna uit, om gewone landsburgers van hul eiendomsreg te vervreem. Nou, Suid-Afrika is groot genoeg, vir allemaal wat kan en hard wil werk, blink toekomst vir hulle te kan bied, ook wat betref eiendomsreg en die bekom van eiendom. Nou, as vroeger gesê, swart mense het nie toegang om eiendom te kan besit nie. Dis net nie so nie. Hulle kan landbank toe gaan, lenings teen baie gunstige koerse aangaan en so op die mark, vrye mark, goeie landbougrond bekom. Verder meer...
Behalwe, as sy kan redeneer, as die 4000 rand per maand kry, hoe kan jy dit doen?
Freek, dit is so. Weet jy, jou minimum loon...
The land bank requires
please,
collateral.
Please respect me. I respect you while
no,
you were talking.
No, me responding has got nothing to do with disrespect.
It is, definitely.
The land bank requires collateral and some kind of surety, which comes in the form of either property or money. Africans don't have collateral, this is the problem with the EFF.
They don't have any respect for anybody. They don't have respect for the history of
Africa.
Telkens skend die staat as instelling. Eers onder die Britte, toe onder die Nationale Partij, nou onder die ANC. Dit is die instelling wat moet regstel. Die staat is die enkel grootste besitter van grond in hierdie land. Hulle kan, as hulle klaar dan oor grondpryse, laat hulle die miljoene hektaar wat in hulle besit is, in die open mark vrystel, so ver gaan, maak die grond spesifiek dan beskikbaar vir swart landbouwers wat wil ekonomies boer. Die tweede belangrike ding is die HOP-huise en die erwe waarop mense in informele nedersettings bly. Dra dit oor, geef vir die mense vol titelaktes. Wat op die oomblik aan die gang is, die staat word net die groter eienaar van eiendom in hierdie land. Daai grond gaan nie oor na swart mense toe nie.
Goed, kom ons oor. There are various proposals on the table. Are none of those acceptable to you? The National Development Plan and the Minister and Quinty's new proposal of 50%. Must go to the workers.
Yes, Frick, the minister's proposal, as you call it, is not a proposal. It was an announcement. And the ANC itself is at loggerheads about this issue. And that's their business. Their internal disagreements are really their business. It doesn't concern us. It was an announcement. It's not government policy. And from their arguments, it doesn't look like it will ever be government policy. EFF is not going to support an announcement of that kind because it doesn't even make sense.
Okay.
It doesn't even make sense. I mean, on what basis and what kind of formula was applied to come up with this 50% of
He's saying that the state is owning a lot of land. And the first thing is the state should actually use that land and give it to the people. Is that something that you would support?
It's not true. It's not true that the state owns a lot of land. That's a very relative statement.
How do you know that?
It's not true.
Where do you get your facts?
80% of this country's land is deemed to be agricultural land. And that 80% of that land is owned by 40,000 individuals, white families.
It's not so.
40,000 out of what's 80% of 50 million? Close to 40 million Africans who are basically landless. Let me give you a very practical example, because I really don't want to engage this gentleman on my right on some of the some of his sentiments. The issues are, we are sitting right now in South Africa with evictions. Where I live, it's Ward 114 under Johannesburg region. The whole of last week, I was basically preoccupied with evictions by the state, of people living in Zandspruit informal settlement, as well as others who live in Honeydew.
But let's try.
No, it comes back to the land issue. Yes, we'll confine it to agriculture, but it comes back to the land issue. So all those people who have been evicted and who are being evicted right from the Western Cape across the country are being evicted.
Okay, can we just get back to agriculture?
Why are they being evicted? Well, we'll come back to agriculture.
Yeah, but
why are
they being evicted? Our time is running. I at least want to understand.
All right.
If you say the state must take the land, all the land, who will get the land on what basis?
The land will be redistributed according to the policies of the EFF once EFF is in government. You must understand that according to EFF, we've got an industrialization policy. And we're a socialist organization. We're not a capitalist organization. So I'm not going to respond to your guests' comments about how we should operate in the free market economy and go to banks and look for money. So the EFF is not part of that agenda at all.
How will you distribute the land?
We distribute the land according to needs. Firstly, there's residential needs. Like I was trying to explain to you, that in Zandspruit, people are displaced, Africans. And South Africans, if I might actually add, predominantly. They have nowhere else to go. Must they dig holes in the ground and live there?
And agricultural land?
Agriculturally. This country currently employs about 700,000 people, right? And I'm including everybody in the agricultural sector. And that 700,000 could be millions if the land was actually productively used and if land wasn't put in the commercial space, because Africans can't compete on that basis. And so there's agricultural needs, there's industrial needs, and there's residential needs.
The whole issue of food security, is that important?
Of course that's important. The fact that 60% of South Africa's consumable goods, including food, is actually it comes from other countries. And South Africa prides itself, even the farming community in South Africa prides itself about how much they produce. Where's that produce? Because of this very same free market economy concept, farmers in South Africa actually produce and prioritize an export market for profits.
Okay.
At the expense of food security.
Wat dink jy is die belangrikste ding wat jy nou kan doen?
Jou belangrikste ding wat ek, jy en elke ander Suid-Afrikaner kan doen, is om in burgerlike instellings betrokke te raak. Die EFF beloof geweld en moord met die beleid wat hulle uiteindelik propageer hierso. Ons kan nie dit toelaat.
Yes, I think that's something
kyk mooi na die propaganda wat hierdie mense maak. Daar is baie mense van welwillendheid in hierdie land. Die EFF wil van jou en my 'n kneg maak in hierdie land. En ons as vry landsburgers kan dit nie toelaat nie. Ons mag dit nie toelaat nie.
Equal redistribution. That includes white South Africans.
Mandisa, is it true what he's saying? Is that it's very difficult for us as on a human level to find each other?
No, that's very untrue. Maybe for him as an individual, because he thinks in a very narrow way. But I think most white, in fact, we've got a lot of white members, Afrikaans. Mm.